Nailed it. GT Racer is a kind of game that you find in your collection of PS2 games and perpetually wonder where it came from. And then I ended up losing it while I was making this episode, so this game did more than just fly under everyone's radar when it came out, it's back to being underneath my own. It wasn't exactly popular either, as it was a budget game made by Axis Entertainment in 2005 and retailed for about $20, $15. As for reviews, it received a single 3.2 review from IGN. GT Racer is so underground, copies of it are probably buried in a landfill underneath unsold copies of Need for Speed Underground. Anyway, the intro that you've been watching right now is, in my opinion, a fairly well-rendered cutscene of the most obscure anime waifu ever, who I'm just gonna pretend is a GT Racer mascot. She acts as a literal booth babe designed to get you to buy the cars. But the game itself, GT Racer, well, it features every standard mode that you'd expect from a racing game. It's got an arcade mode, a career mode, and only a small handful of tracks and cars that all handle pretty much the same. I'm just gonna come out and say it. This is objectively a bad game. There is a small and dedicated fanbase for it, and good for them, but while there's a lot of things that I like about this game, the gameplay does not click with me at all. This might seem a bit odd considering that I played Crazy Frog Arcade Racer, but that was a bad idea with mediocre gameplay. This is a flipped version of that, a mediocre idea with worse gameplay. And there's a lot of things that I can justifiably praise about GT Racer. The Fox motion blur caused by the renderer ghosting the last frame is not one of them, but the rest? Well, I can't deny that the game itself looks really good, mostly because it's only running at 30 FPS. Unless you're driving during the middle of the night, because the lighting's only great during the day. The night? Completely different story. Granted, I'm just mostly impressed with the real-time reflections on the cars, which I didn't even know was possible in the PS2. Plus, I've complained about pop-in before in video games, and this game has only a single noticeable moment with it. It also comes with anti-aliasing on a PS2 no less, and this is before SMAA. I don't know what kind of dark wizardry they did, but it looks surprisingly good, even though I only record at 480i. What I'm trying to say is, it looks really good for a PS2 game, and it's a shame that it's a bit unoptimized, because the game appears to only be double buffered, so when the frame rate has to suffer, it drops hard. Speaking of dropping hard, the gameplay. It's bad. There's no way around this. The driving seems tolerable, but its Achilles heel is that it has an unnaturally high skill floor. The handling causes you to understeer or oversteer most of the time, unless you take the turns as slow as possible. GT Racer does come with a handful of driving assists, and I recommend you keep everything but drifting on. With none of the assists, the game literally becomes unbeatable as your car is forced to lose speed every time you adjust the steering wheel, and you kinda have to do that a lot. With all of the assists, the game likes to pretend it's a knockoff of Initial D, but I've never managed to pull off a single drift that saves me more time than just hitting the brakes. With steering assists and no drifting, the game becomes the most tolerable, which is just my fancy way of saying least user hostile. In the best of days, you drive like a cardboard box bordering on black ice. GT Racer is unique in that the cars both have a reasonable sense of weight while driving, and the most comically low weight in midair. Granted, it's designed so you can take off flying and destroy your ride because cars shouldn't fly, but on the San Juan stage, the little curbs are treated as ramps for Arthur Weasley's Ford Anglia from Harry Potter. The handling isn't even half bad most of the time, it's just a little bit of time that it decides to play the fun game of Russian roulette with a semi-automatic, and no matter how good of a driver you think you are in real life, your skills don't transfer here at all. Now, I'm not gonna pretend that I'm the Jesus Christ of driving a Honda Civic, but I've lost control of that in a snowstorm with no ABS or winter tires when I tried to stop at a red light, and even though I was metaphorically shitting my pants, I felt more in control then than at any moment when I lost control in this game. Granted, I could be driving like an old lady, which is totally safe, but this is a racing game, and the AI is only tolerant of my baby boomer brand bullshit for so long. It's weird, because GT Racer feels like it tries to be both arcadey and like a simulation at the same time, but it does neither of them well. I've played other games that required perfection, and this is up there in the amount of inane bullshit I had to deal with. Arcade mode? Yeah, it sucks. I spent way too much time trying to play it responsively, and I found tricks to get first most of the time, but there's always going to be some moment that the AI takes advantage of, and I'm not good enough at the game to catch up to a driver that knows how to drive straight without crashing into the absolute nothing in my way, especially when they literally have better cars than you do. And at that point, I just decided to take a nap, woke up, and somehow beat the final level of the arcade mode that I was stuck for a good hour on the first try. I'm not sure how, but this somehow led me to the secret credits that weren't even on YouTube until last month, but that's spoiler territory. Point is, it is doable, it's just needlessly hard. But what about the Grand Prix mode? Okay, let me rephrase that question. Do you really think the Grand Prix mode is better? At this point, you're basically asking whether you want to dive from a 7.63 round or a 5.56. Grand Prix has another layer of frustration, namely fuel. I'm not going to pretend to be my imaginary audience and make arguments for the presence of fuel in racing games, because you're not wrong, not even remotely wrong, but you have to deal with gas, and no matter what car you have, you'll only get a few laps out of your fuel tank, if that, and you need to fill it up either in the middle of a race, which costs time, or between races, which costs money. See, and I wouldn't be complaining that much about fuel in a video game if it wasn't for the fact that your car is constantly leaking it. You might be able to get like 5 laps on the most basic circuit before you're already so low on fuel that, yeah, you have to pull over. The only good part about this fuel system is that it opens up an amazing exploit. When you buy a car, you can sell it for the exact price you bought it for, and every car comes with 80% of its tank filled. Now you can also sell the fuel that you do have, so long as you have 15% of gas left. Since every car has the same gas capacity, you can sell about 195 credits worth of gas, and then your car, leading to that tiny margin. The problem with this, however, is that it requires like 4 different menus, and that takes up a lot of time, and it's honestly only worth it if you're done like $500 or something. Thankfully, the game is a bit merciful by giving you reward money after each race as well, except for a few cups, but between your handling being garbage and you needing to pay for repairs and fuel all the time, you're gonna be bleeding money. But if you don't want to bleed money, this game has some amazing cheat codes. You start off with only a few $1,000s. How'd you like 2 billion? That's enough to buy every car in this game 100 times over and still have hundreds of millions left. If you want a really solid challenge, learn how to drive in this game and enjoy Grand Prix. But if you actually want to have some fun once you're in life, use a cheat. For example, did you know that there's a race that costs $400,000 to enter? It's a single race on the longest, hardest map, San Juan, and it's 36 laps. 36 laps. There's no way that I would have known this was a thing because the entry fee is nearly 30 times what you start off with in the game, and it's non-refundable. A single lap takes about 2 minutes, so you'd be literally sitting there for over an hour, being the most careful grandma ever, lest you break your car or hit a bump the wrong way and flip yourself. While I don't condone cheating in online games, do what you want in single player, and I wanted to see what the game had without looking up needlessly complex ways to kill myself with a DualShock 2 controller. But before I forget, I did mention that the game has pretty good graphics, but you know what would be even nicer? Being able to see. This game has some of the worst night driving I've ever played in a game. The night driving shows the limitations of their pre-baked lighting, but not including headlights. Headlights. Seriously, I've played PS1 budget racing games that had headlights, even though it was a basic polygon and some texture filtering to increase brightness of the polys ahead. These guys have created real-time reflections, but couldn't do that. Otherwise, the environments are amazing. It looks good when cloudy, it looks good when sunny, it looks good in the city, and even better in the country. They faked some god rays here, that's a lot more than what I was expecting. This actually makes me feel like I'm driving on a road out in the country somewhere, except the road is really wide and I'm violating a lot of speeding laws right now. And if it wasn't for the night, I'd probably say that this game nails environments perfectly. Let's talk about the music. It's not bad. It's a lot of licensed trance from DJ Tiesto in a single 10-second loop from Airport Terminal by NMR, who appears to only exist to make music for Dance Dance Revolution games. I'm not sure what the story is here, and I don't really care. The rest of the music is, well, it's all from a very 2000s nightclub, and I'm not a fan of it. If you like repetitive EDM and breaking open glow sticks to drink the hydrogen peroxide and phenol within, yeah, this stuff is for you. It just didn't hit me. And with that, this should give you a good enough look at DT Racer and how it perfectly fits into the bottom of the dumpster fire. It's not quite as in-depth as I wanted it to be, but you know what? I'm still comfortable with giving it a final rating of Student Driver Simulator 2005. But you know what? This is bottom of the dumpster fire. I find interesting facts. This game is also the exclusive holder of Student Driver Simulator 2003 award. Unlike other things, it's more of an interesting footnote than a hidden gem, but DT Racer is a port of a Korean PS2 game called Axel Impact The Extreme Racing, and I've been legitimately trying to find a physical copy since August of last year. The only reason why I even wanted to do this in the first place was because someone online said that the handling is different and I was wondering if it was better or worse. But yeah, let's go on to eBay. There's not a single copy there. Yahoo Auctions? Nope, nothing in Japan. PlayAsia had copies at some point, but not anymore. And South Korea's G Market only had golf clubs. The official site went down a while back, but it still wasn't even updated since 2005, so nothing of value was really lost. But still, sometimes you really want a Korean game nobody else has ever heard of. Well, I guess I have to find a bootleg copy of it. I don't like using pirate copies of games that didn't come out like that. I prefer to have actual copies, but, you know, I've got to at least try Axel Impact. If the developers behind it are watching, I'm sorry for pirating the Korean version of your game. I sent my $20 Canadian to make up for it, but I don't know to whom or why. Was this game even $20? So yeah, Axel Impact. This is going to be hard to review considering it's still the same game under the hood. I've also swapped the backing music to the generic rock that you hear in it compared to DJ Tiesto, and the only song that's the same between the two versions is a 5-second loop in the menus. I don't know what it is about the music, but this with the visual scream Korean racing game, whereas the American version was Get High With Your Friends off of Antifreeze. Nothing against the American soundtrack, the soundtrack is actually more grating than DJ Tiesto, especially since you get an uncomfortably long pause whenever it wants to start over. But in my opinion, this fits the game much better. As for the game itself, well, it's missing the driving assists, but it is set up exactly the same way that I like DT Racer, which is nice. The graphics are noticeably simpler, but it's also without the ghosting that I disliked, so honestly I'd probably say that it's better, even though it performs worse framerate-wise. The levels have a lot more crap and debris splattered all over them that slow you down, kind of like in the intro, but San Juan? It's a massive improvement. There's no bumps that I hate, the edges are all smoothed out, the level is a lot easier, like, I genuinely prefer this version over DT Racer. The nighttime driving is also a lot easier because the image is clear, even though it's still without headlights. The game is missing some things such as the endgame car in DT Racer, but that's a non-issue at all. The controls are just as bad, but the more basic level design makes this more forgiving to play. I feel like the handling is also improved in the Korean version, but I'm not actually sure if it's just me being aware of the game's tomfuckery at this point. But more forgiving doesn't mean easier. The amount of laps they expect you to do here is more than the American version, and the difficulty is higher as a result. Like for example, the endurance race is 40 laps in Axel Impact, and most other races have a few extra laps tacked on as well. But you don't have the risk of accidentally sending yourself into the stratosphere on San Juan. You are missing the nitrous boost that the American version gives you, which was a great way of catching up or breaking away from the crowd, but it's as much of a blessing as it was a curse there, because you had to push in the analog stick to use it, and you risk flying head-on into the nearest wall when you did. Now that I think of the nitrous, what I neglected to mention was that the AI in this game is also surprisingly fair. On easy mode, they don't use nitrous at all, but they play by the rules, they're just better at them than you are. The fact that you can be knocked around like a pinball isn't exclusive just to you, too. I've seen the AI players be both flipped on their head and flown off into the space just because they were in the way of some other driver. It's a fair challenge, and games aren't noticed enough for these kinds of accomplishments. And Axel Impact? Well, it's just as good about this as GT Racer. This doesn't mean that I've had a change of heart and decided to change the final review score. Axel Impact's final score is still Student Driver Simulator 2003, but whereas GT Racer would have gotten a D, Axel Impact gets a D+. They both pass, but barely, and they shouldn't get a chance to continue their brand. But Axis Entertainment did though, with DT Carnage in 2008. So, what should you do when you find a copy of DT Racer? Well, if it's like $2, you can grab it and try it out, then put it on your shelf and never look at it again. That's what I'm gonna do as soon as I find my copy. Oh, who am I kidding? None of you guys are gonna go out and buy the game. It's time for the spoilers. So, you apparently unlock the secret credits by being real fucking good at this game, which I'm not. And it's mostly just the developers talking about how thankful they are, how periodically bullshit development was, and how friendly some female teenage retail employees are. So yeah, as a reward, here's the cheat code you won't find on any cheat site. R1, R1, triangle, triangle. What does it do? I think it unlocks all cars, but I'm not sure. I just want to play a good racing game at this point.